Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's fourth meeting of 2021. Apologies for this morning's meeting have been received from Evelyn Tweed, and I would like to welcome Marie McNair, who's attending this morning's meeting in Evelyn's absence. Our first agenda item this morning is to invite Marie McNair to declare any relevant interest to the committee. Marie.
Good morning, Convener. I can confirm that I am an elected member of West Dunbartonshire Council, and up until June of this year, I was a part-time social care worker.
Thank you. Our second item today is to consider whether to take item 4 in private to consider the evidence heard on the Minister's Session 6 priorities. Are members agreed? We're agreed. Thank you. So now on to our third item today, and that's to take evidence from the Minister for Drugs Policy on her priorities for Session 6. Can I welcome Angela Constance, the Minister for Drugs Policy, and remotely should be joined by her officials, Michael Crook, Head of the Drugs Death Team, Drugs Policy Division, and Maurice Fraser, the Head of Delivery and Support Unit for the Drugs Policy Division of the Scottish Government. Minister, I believe that you have a brief opening statement.
I do indeed, Convener, and I'm very grateful to committee this morning for the opportunity to provide evidence on my priorities going forward over the next 5 years. The loss of life from drug-related deaths is as heartbreaking as it is unacceptable, and I once again offer my condolences to all those who have lost a loved one, and my continuing commitment to do everything possible during this parliamentary session and beyond to turn the tide on drug-related deaths. This morning, the Scottish Government published the first quarterly reports on suspected drug deaths. This first report focuses on management information from Police Scotland and covers the first two quarters of 2021, the first 6 months of our national mission. And while this report is not a replacement for the drug-related death national statistics published annually by National Records of Scotland on the confirmed drug deaths, and as this information is official statistics based on death registration records supplemented by the information from the Crown Office and forensic pathologists. Nonetheless, this information on suspected drug deaths will help services to respond to what is needed more quickly and will also help Parliament monitor progress. And it provides a barometer of drug death trends over time. So we can very cautiously take some encouragement from what appears to be a slightly lower figure of suspected drug deaths than for the same period last year. But I do want to stress there is a long way to go here, and whether suspected drug-related deaths or actual drug-related deaths, both remain too high in Scotland today. So my priorities, Convener, start with getting more people into protective treatment and recovery on the back of our commitment to an additional investment of £250 million, including £100 million for residential rehabilitation over this parliamentary term. Information from quarterly reporting will allow me to set a treatment target for 2022, which is one of my main priorities. Implementing the medication-assisted treatment standards by April 2022 is a key priority as well. These standards set out what people should expect and can demand from services, in particular same-day treatment and access to a wider range of medication-assisted treatment options. And this is part of our overall approach to making people's rights a reality. But the options being offered to people must also include access to residential rehabilitation, which is clearly a priority for us all. We recognise that in polydrug use deaths, the number of cases involving methadone and benzodiazepine has risen. We need to understand how this is happening and be able to offer safer alternatives, for example, like Buvidol, a new treatment to reduce overdose cases. So the role of prescribers, including GPs, will be absolutely crucial in all this. In October, the Advisory Committee on the Misuse of Drugs will have its first meeting in Scotland. And there will be a Four Nations Drugs meeting in Belfast later that month also, and I will be using this opportunity to continue to press the UK Government on the evidence for drug checking facilities and safe consumption rooms whilst pursuing further action via our own devolved powers. I will continue to prioritise people with lived and living experience through local panels and a national collaborative. This already plays a vital role in service design and delivery across Scotland, but my priority will be ensuring that everyone's rights to the highest standard of healthcare is made a reality. We will also continue to strengthen the links across portfolios. Our mission is linked to other vital work to improve mental health, to address poverty and inequality, to ensure we are keeping the promise to our children, to build resilience through education and prevention, and to bring public health approaches to our justice system. And another priority will be to develop and upskill women-specific services, and I announced that Phoenix Future has been successful in principle in a bid to establish a new national specialist family service. That facility will be the first of what I hope will be many new residential rehabilitation facilities, and I will be setting out milestones for further growth over the next 5 years to Parliament shortly. I will be continuing to prioritise the use of naloxone. Its services have made great strides, but I want to see more. We launched a national naloxone campaign last month, which has already significantly increased demand through our third sector partners. And I'm also encouraging community pharmacists to be more active in the use of naloxone too. And in November, we'll launch a campaign to tackle stigma, which is still for many people a barrier to accessing life-saving services. I'm also making it a priority to see alcohol and drug services feature within the proposed National Care Service. This is a real opportunity to consider how we can better support some of Scotland's most marginalised and vulnerable people. And in conclusion, Convener, I'm very conscious that it's not possible to cover everything in detail or every priority over the next parliamentary term in the time that we have available. But I hope that this summary is helpful to committee and is very much the start of a conversation that we'll have over the years. And I will, of course, continue to update Parliament regularly. So thank you.
Thank you. That's been very helpful. And a number of things in there that colleagues are going to come in and ask you more detail on. I guess I was wanting to sort of like open up by asking you reflections on you've been in post for about 9 months now, and you've outlined some of your sort of strategies and priorities. Over the 9 months, and given you have got a hinterland and a lot of experience in a lot of the related areas that have an impact on drug use in Scotland, what's your assessment of how we've got to this place and how, what are you prepared to consider within the bounds of what we can do in Scotland, but also perhaps pushing the boundaries of what we need to do in Scotland going forward?
So for me, Convener, it's always about following the evidence and what works and listening to people who are most affected by drug deaths in our communities, and that is people with lived experience but also people with living experience. In terms of encapsulating where we are and, if you like, why Scotland, why is our challenge so acute and severe? I suppose I have my own views on that, and I know that in the past there have been many, I suppose, discussions about culture, about patterns of drug use, about concentrated, levels of priority. But I suppose I always distill our challenge in Scotland into three areas. We have a higher proportion of people who use drugs. And of course, I suppose that's quite an existential question as to why that is. And there's much research into that as well. But we need to recognise that we have a higher proportion of our people who use drugs, and therefore we have proportionately more people with problem drug use. And actually the rate of drug use in Scotland is about double that in England, south of the border. The other issue is around benzodiazepines. Illicit benzodiazepines is an issue across the UK, but it is more acute in Scotland, and again, the facts would show that. So since 2009 in Scotland, there's been a 450% increase in the implication of benzodiazepines in drug deaths. By comparison, south of the border, it's 53%. And again, to be frank, and this is at the heart of the matter, we don't have enough of our people in treatment. So that's the core of my assessment, is we don't have enough of our people in treatment. We know that treatment is protective, and what we need to do is get that culture of change, that culture of compassion in our services, so that people can access services easier, that services can be more fleet of foot in terms of following people up, and people should have informed choices about their services and treatment too. You know, we have made other progress around other preventable deaths. We must consider drug deaths as not just tragic but also preventable, and that while the scale of the challenge is massive, we can and we must turn this around.
Thank you for that. And there's a couple of things in there that I want to pick up on specifically. You were saying we don't have enough people in treatment. And I think, is there two parts to that, really? It's getting access to getting hold of people and giving them the pathways to get treatment. And it's having enough capacity in treatment as well. And straying into that area of what's reserved and what's devolved, the drug consumption facilities, is it fair to say they're more than just a facility to have safe use of drugs? They're of a pathway as well to getting people into treatment. And also, where do you see GPs in this? Because people might not actually be in treatment, but most people are registered with a GP, so that is obviously an early intervention pathway for people as well. How do you see both of those things perhaps matching up and helping people get into treatment?
Okay, so what we know in terms of emergency interventions, harm reduction interventions such as safe consumption rooms, and indeed the heroin assisted treatment project in Glasgow, that not only helps reach people where they are at any particular time and helps them reduce the risks that they face at that time, but it is part of a longer conversation, a longer journey that can help people connect with other services. And that may be connecting with primary care. It may be, you know, connecting with services in and around bloodborne viruses. It may be, you know, helping people with the practicalities of addressing other issues in their life, whether it's, you know, problems with, you know, more personal care, housing, or perhaps even, you know, some of the underlying causes. But the importance of harm reduction, and all the evidence would show this, it's about meeting people where they are now and working with them through the good times and the bad, sticking with them in whatever they choose their onward journey to be. And in terms of your distillation, convener, that yes, we need to increase capacity of services, and that will involve work around workforce planning, for example. There is lots of baseline information that we don't have, so we need to do, you know, update our work, and in the process of updating work around prevalence, about baseline information about the number of people in treatment, and that will help us, you know, make progress with things like our target to treatment. But it is clear, I mean, people in this committee will know the issues that are reserved and the issues that are devolved. But the challenge for us is leaving no stone unturned, that whatever our powers are, whatever resources we have at our disposal, we make all the vital connections and take every opportunity to implement evidence-based practice.
Okay. Sandish, you want to ask a supplementary question on what I've just raised there? If it could be short, please, and then I'll move on to Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Minister. My question is just pressing a little bit more on what Gillian asked specifically about why you feel that GPs, what their role is going forward.
So that is a really important question, Mr. Gullion. I know you're a former GP, and I often talk about our life-saving work being connected to the work to improve people's lives. And you and I may take for granted the role of primary care in our own lives, and I know that there are many GP practices that are actually at the front line of our communities and that are already doing great work to support people and their families struggling with drug use. What we find across Scotland is that there is a different picture between how services are organised. So in some areas of Scotland, GPs can offer more services to people affected with drug use. In other areas, the pathways and the routes point more towards specialist services. And regional variation is, of course, fine as long as it is working. But in terms of taking a public health approach, there is an absolutely core role for GPs in all of this. And it's part of my job to engage with clinicians from all backgrounds, whether it's psychiatrists, whether it's GPs, whether it's, you know, specialist addiction services. But and that connection, and this is my final point, Convener, of the importance between, you know, harm reduction and immediate access to treatment for a drug problem with primary care is made in Standard 7 in the new medication-assisted treatment standards, and that people should have the choice that, you know, in terms of that connection between their MAT treatment and primary care.
Thank you. And questions from Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Almost a lot of Scotland's drug deaths involve more than one substance, and drug death figures show a continued upward trend in cocaine being implicated as a cause of death. The Scottish Drugs Forum has warned that efforts to get more people into treatment must take account of the needs of people using cocaine as well as those using depressant drugs. Minister, could you outline how you will ensure that drug treatment services serves the needs of people using cocaine and those who use a number of substances?
Yeah, and that's a really important point that Ms. Mackay makes. And at the core of this is about person-centred care. Because where we get into real complexity, we have to watch that while there are different treatments, medication-assisted treatments that are geared towards opioid dependency and opioid substitution therapy and methadone and Buvidal, we have to watch that we don't have services that are siloed, because the number of people who die from where cocaine is the only implicated drug is comparatively small. I think it's about 16 deaths. So what we're looking at here is cocaine in the context of polydrug misuse. So that's a much more complex picture. So we have to be taking this down to the individual. And services have to be about engaging with individuals as individuals first and foremost, and working out what support and help they need. The point about cocaine is important because we have seen a 23-25% increase in the implication of cocaine in drug-related deaths. There's a lot of information about the increase in purity, but also the lowering of price. And where we must also think about our approach with services is that cocaine use features more amongst younger people. I mean, I'm generalising a bit here, but in terms of, you know, opioid use, that in general tends to be, perhaps people, you know, over 25, whereas, you know, there's a rise in cocaine use amongst younger people. And so, you know, some services, depending on the age of the person, you know, will need to be age appropriate. So there's a different pattern of drug use amongst young people. So there's no easy answers But we need to be thinking about whole packages of care and support and get underneath the skin of why people use drugs and particular substances.
Thank you. And now can I go remotely to Marie McNair, who's got some questions around prevention and early intervention. Marie.
Good morning, Minister. You will agree that the reason for addiction are complex and multifaceted, and will never address the problem without joint working across all disciplines. Is the government doing enough to fund effective integrated working to cover health, social work, housing, training and employment?
So Ms McNair is absolutely right to make those vital connections. That is why we have a national mission in the first place. We need to be taking that helicopter whole systems approach, and at its core is also early intervention and prevention. So this is about our work in terms of poverty. This is our work with, you know, young people within our health system and in our education system. We probably know much more about what works with young people now than we did, say, 20 years ago. You know, in the context of Curriculum for Excellence, we know that young people respond better to approaches that are about upskilling them, about increasing their personal resilience, self-esteem, you know, confidence, obviously diversion, activity opportunities within communities. The point about housing is very well made. You know, there's a massive investment planned in increasing the supply of affordable housing over the lifetime of this Parliament, with some very stretching goals of, you know, 110,000 houses by 2032. And all of this work must connect with GIRFECT and, you know, keeping the promise. So there are some examples within my own division in terms of the drugs policy division about our investment with families, you know, supporting family inclusive approaches. There are particular funds that are for work with, you know, families and children, but it's absolutely vital that drugs policy is connected with every aspect of government policy, every aspect.
Marie?
Thank you.
And can I pick up on one of the things you said about about families? You mentioned that the services for women, and I think particularly one of the things, I was watching your evidence session from the committee in the last session in March, and you picked up on some of the historical difficulties I have for women who've got caring responsibilities and families getting access to treatment. Can you give maybe a bit more information on how you've moved on that and what interventions you're putting in place to help more women with families get the treatment that they need?
Yeah, okay. We know that there is often a great fear amongst women in terms of reaching out for help and disclosing, you know, the level of their drug use, particularly if they have children. And that's one reason, there are many, why we are investing in whole family approaches and family inclusive practice. So you may, committee may recall that when I made the statement to Parliament on the 3rd of August, that we made an announcement around a substantial investment in an organisation called Phoenix Future, and that is about establishing a national residential family service for the whole of Scotland. And that announcement outlined that, you know, subject to various approvals and, you know, consultation within the communities, that this facility would be able to accommodate up to 20 families, actually, you know, both mums and dads who have children between, you know, birth and 11 years of age, We do, of course, need to, as well as thinking about services on a national level, we do also need to be thinking about them on a more regional basis as well. So that is one example of a step forward. And, you know, there will be other work and announcements in due course. There is, in terms of the funding that we have channelled through alcohol and drug partnerships, there is a specific allocation of £3.5 million for local ADPs to be invested in whole family approaches. We need to be supporting families as a collective unit, but we also need to be supporting individuals within families in their own right as well. And we'll be publishing a framework around what family inclusive practice, you know, should look and feel like on the ground. So we are making progress in this area, and of course I'll keep committee informed.
That's really helpful. Annie Wells wants to come in with a supplementary on this. Annie.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Minister. Thank you very much for attending. I've just been trolling through the latest statistics. But, Minister, the police division with the greatest number of suspected drug deaths was Greater Glasgow at 187. This was followed by Lanarkshire with 67, Edinburgh City 64, and Tayside 64. Can I just ask if there's any specific work taking place in these divisions to see what the issue is here and how we can help and support these people?
So thank you, Ms. Wells, for that question. In terms of the information published this morning on suspected drug deaths, you're quite correct to point out that this information is in the context of police divisions. It is suspected drug deaths on the basis of the inquiries made by the attending police officer at the time. What this information won't tell us is things like the use of substances potentially involved. We get that level of detail from the annual report on confirmed cases. There is, of course, a lot of work. If we take, you know, Glasgow, for example, a few weeks ago, I went out to visit the Glasgow overdose response team. And that is a service that is looking to quickly follow people up who have survived a near-fatal overdose, because what we know from looking at successive annual reports is that more than half of our people who die have a history of overdose. So when people survive a near-fatal overdose, we really need services to kick in quickly. And of course, there are a range of projects, you know, funded through some of the community funds, new funds that we've opened, you know, the local alcohol and drug partnership, and some of the drug death task force projects are specific to Glasgow as well. We do have information that is available, convener, on a more kind of regional basis in terms of specific services and specific projects or specific tests of change. It might be helpful if I can pull some of that together and share with committee, because I know, you know, there's a broad selection of MSPs here from across the country that you'll be very interested to look at that in detail.
That would be really helpful. Thank you. Can I come to Paul Kane quickly on this?
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Minister. I think just to follow up that point, because I think we all understand the importance of further understanding when someone perhaps overdoses and they are treated, essentially, or they attend hospital, and understanding the information and patterns around that. So I'm just keen to understand, in terms of reporting, what can we further do to have further data on that? Because obviously the hospital admission information doesn't cover, for example, A&E attendances or when people are treated by the Scottish Ambulance Service. So I suppose just asking the Minister for her thoughts on how can we get more data in terms of where people are treated and making sure that we follow up with them.
So I'm absolutely committed to getting more information and more data that will help us improve our services and improve our offering, and to really tie in that every step of our national mission is based in evidence and, you know, what we know are the issues here in Scotland. So in terms of those, and I think Mr. Keane, your question is certain, it seems to me to be around the how we actually link information and link data. In very general terms, the annual report gives us some, you know, quite rich information around substances. That information is also available local authority by local authority, and it's also available kind of month by month. The issue about being able to understand more about other health problems in the context of drug use and involvement with other services is really important, because some of that information we do have. So we know things like information about drug-related admissions to accident emergency or psychiatric admissions, but there is a bit of a time lag in that information. So some of the work that we're doing with Public Health Scotland is about how can we get that type of detailed information more quickly. And it's also about, we can in time, notwithstanding the time lags, we can gather quite a lot of information that tells us that the circumstances around people's tragic deaths. I would suggest we need to know more about people's lives, and while part of that absolutely connects with our lived and living experience strategy and our engagement with services locally, that there's data around that as well that tells us more about the lives people lead that will help us shape services as well. And we also, you know, need more of that data to have those quality indicators that will underpin our treatment target as well.
And I'm going to bring in Carol Mock. And Carol, you've got questions around inequalities.
Lovely, thanks. Thanks very much for your answers so far around treatment and families. Along with this, I'm very keen for us to explore the sort of link between social inequalities and deprivation and poverty. I think it's really important to have some understanding of the commitment from yourself, obviously, in the government to make use of all the powers that we have to make sure that we tackle childhood poverty, housing issues, employment opportunities for people. And I just wondered if you could give us a little bit of feedback on your thoughts on those issues.
Yeah, no, it's a really good point. I reiterate this often, but it absolutely is about connecting the emergency life-saving work with the work that improves life chances. And what we know, I mean, the statistics speak for themselves. We know that people in the poorest communities are 18 times more likely to suffer a drug-related death than those people in the least deprived communities. It is important to stress that drug-related deaths and drug use is an issue across all of Scotland, in that the drug-related death in the Highlands is the lowest drug-related death in Scotland, but it is still higher than the drug-related death in the northeast of England. So that gives, I think, I hope, some context that this is an all Scotland problem. But there is no doubt about it that the increase in drug-related deaths has been driven by an increase in the poorest people in our communities dying. There's absolutely no doubt about that. So therefore, you know, the work on child poverty, for example, is absolutely crucial. So, you know, we know there's a £23 million Tackling Child Poverty Fund, and a cross-government child poverty action plan. Colleagues here will be well aware of the plans in and around the Scottish child payment. But that work also has to connect with drugs policy work, but also, again, that bigger, you know, government approach where, you know, £2 billion of our resources are invested in low-income families. And, you know, I think around half of that is much more focused towards families or households with children. So £2 billion investment is in endeavours to alleviate pressures on low-income households. And then there's a proportion of that for households with children. But this, you know, it's connected with the our economy, you know, the Fair Work agenda. I mean, all of these things, you know, you could talk in detail about, as well as the work and around adverse childhood experiences and trauma. And of course, you know, ACEs, you know, have a huge link to people's, you know, living environment as well.
Thanks, Carol. I'm going to move on to talk about sort of other issues around drugs policy, particularly around the progress and your priorities. And the, I believe Gillian Mackay's got some questions in this area.
So specifically on treatment, when people leave residential rehabilitation, they are at increased risk of overdoses. Their tolerance to drugs will have lowered by the period of abstinence. I think it's important that we recognise that people do not leave rehab cured, and that they often need ongoing treatment and support. So how will the government ensure that residential rehab services are well integrated with other health and care services, and that follow-up support is provided to those when they leave rehab?
So absolutely, in terms of our commitment to increase the capacity and the reach and improve access to residential rehab, that is very much in the context of aftercare as well. We have to recognise that this can be a chronic condition. It should be of no surprise to anyone involved in providing drug services that sometimes people relapse. Progress in life is rarely linear, and this shouldn't be about people running out of chances. We should be giving people as many chances as they need to get on to the road to recovery. So the work that we're doing with local services and that integration with aftercare is crucially important. And we also need to think about rehabilitation within a community context as well as a residential context. But we know that times of transition, so leaving residential rehab is a time where risk can be elevated, so people must have that wraparound person-centred support that meets their needs. It also applies to people leaving prison. It applies to other changes where people might be moving or leaving services. Our work and investments in and around outreach are particularly important in this area. And also, when people disengage from services, we need to be far better at following that up too.
Particularly around access, picking up earlier on the issues around access to rehab as well. Obviously, there's been a greater discussion about residential rehab and how that interacts with the rest of the mix of treatment options. But many people might be afraid they'd lose their tenancy if they enter rehab. They may have caring responsibilities, as the convener pointed to earlier on. And for people who have unplanned discharges from treatment and things, and integrating the naloxone carrying for police and for hopefully for the wider public as well, how do you see the sort of you've touched on it slightly, but the integration across various aspects of government in terms of supporting people in their tenancies, encouraging more people to take up carrying naloxone so that it is something that can be used to support particularly those people who do find themselves in a period of homelessness, as many people with drug and alcohol addiction do.
Yeah. So there's a lot in that question, convener, but the member is quite right to be making all of those connections. So the point about access, for example, into residential rehabilitation is important. The work that is being undertaken by the Residential Rehab Development Working Group is about developing clearer pathways, because pathways vary across the country, and I think I'm on record as saying that sometimes pathways into residential rehab are as clear as mud, and that's not right, and it's not acceptable. But there's also an issue about access into community services. So if I compare, so there can be many barriers. You know, you have to do this, you have to be on this level of treatment, you have to be abstinent or whatever. So sometimes we need to be thinking about what are the barriers to getting people into treatment. Now, in terms of residential rehab, which is a abstinence-based model, there are obviously certain expectations around people's personal commitment and detox and lowering substances, to facilitate that. But I think, it's a fair point to point to, that there are perhaps too many barriers to access and other services. And one of the early actions I took, and it was a result of information that Shelter had provided with me, there's a bit of confusion around housing benefit rules. And of course, if you know anything about housing benefit, there's a minutiae of detail at times often to be unravelled. And there was different things happening in different local authority areas in terms of applying, rules. And what I was not going to put up with is people having to choose between keeping their tenancy and going into residential rehab. So there is funds, allocated and available to address that whilst we sort out the complexities around, regulation or whatever. And I think that's just one example of where, we can invest resource, because we're just not putting up with that. We'll sort it out, but we're just not putting up with that. We can't have that choice. I've always been a big fan of Housing First and other housing models that, aren't putting up other barriers, that we take people as they are. The priority is to get people into a house, into a home, and then we will work out the rest. Whether it's people's drug use or their health problems or other issues. I've certainly spoke about parents and mothers in particular with care and responsibilities, so I won't repeat that. And the issue about naloxone is really important, because it helps save lives. It buys some time for emergency services. It temporarily reverses the impact of an opioid overdose. It is safe and easy to use. And the work of the previous Lord Advocate, as a result of the pandemic, he issued guidance that enabled us to widen the distribution of naloxone into third sector settings. I have to give a shout out to Scottish families affected by alcohol and drugs as a result of people going to the our national naloxone campaign and people going to the Stop the Deaths website. They have had over 460 people, applying for these kits. They provide a kind of click and deliver service. So, families who have a loved one at risk, can have naloxone at hand. Nearly over two-thirds of ambulance technicians are, trained in naloxone and, give out the take-home kits to people they come across. But it's also important that, for those that are distributing naloxone and non-drug services, that they're also making those connections and helping to support people and refer people to drug services. So I hope, my apologies for the length of that reply, convener, but I hope I've managed to at least outline some of the very important connections.
Just before I hand over to Paula Kane, you mentioned the ambulance service have naloxone and families can apply to. Where are the police in this with their policy on it? Are they carrying naloxone?
So there are three areas in Scotland where the police are carrying naloxone. That is in the east end of Glasgow, Falkirk and Dundee. And, you know, that pilot has been successful and naloxone has been used 40 times, I believe, back by the police. There is a review period that we have now entered into. And, of course, we, you know, will want to have a discussion with justice colleagues about how that programme could be extended. Because this... You know, it's important that statutory services play their part, and that also helps us communicate with the wider communities and the wider population that actually that there is a tool that can be used, you know, to help prevent people dying whilst, you know, help has been called. We, of course, you know, need to be preventing people having an overdose in the first place. I think we'd certainly covered that extensively at the part of the session. But, you know, naloxone is one part of the jigsaw. You know, there are other parts of the jigsaw that's about preventing people getting into crisis in the first place. And then, you know, other parts of the jigsaw are what happens when people survive and overdose, how we, you know, connect them with support services.
Quick supplement from Emma Harper, and I'll come to Paul.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Just to pick up on what Convener is saying about naloxone, the frontline workers that are now testing the naloxone pilot, ambulance crews and the frontline police officers and even families that are being trained to use naloxone, what's the perception of how that's been received? Are they? Is it been positive for all the frontline workers who are engaging in the naloxone testing?
I mean, I think that's certainly my understanding. If I take the police, for example, you know, there is a very high proportion of police officers who have, you know, after they have undertaken the training, you know, will carry naloxone. When you speak to families, as I do, and I'm sure many members around here do, you know, they will give many examples of how, you know, naloxone has, you know, saved the life of a loved one. When you speak to people of lived and living experience, they will talk about actually the range of services that have helped them on their journey. And I think the key challenge for us now is to widen that distribution and for it not to retract. So the Scottish Government, we're participating in a four nations consultation about permanently widening the distribution of naloxone, although safe to use, is a controlled drug. And the Lord Advocate, as a result of the pandemic, was able to use his discretion to give confidence to widen the distribution to non-drug services where people actually, you know, whether it's homelessness services, for example. So we now need the changes that the Lord Advocate made in Scotland as a result of the pandemic to be permanently made. So there's a UK-wide consultation, it's a Four Nations consultation, and we're participating in that. Even although, you know, I had some concerns about, you know, some of the language used in the consultation and the scope of the consultation. Nonetheless, the Scottish Government have participated in that Four Nations consultation because we want to see a permanent change to the arrangements made to widen the distribution of naloxone.
Okay, thank you. Paul.
Thank you, Convener. Prior to summer recess, we obviously had a debate on many of these issues, and I think quite a consensual debate around certainly the medication-assisted treatment standards and the need for the strong implementation of those, and I think a timely implementation of those. So I think I'm keen to hear from the Minister just an update on our progress towards that, obviously having set the date of April 2022. As a target, and I think as a follow-up to that, if I can, just how will that progress be reported? Because I think also the Minister had made commitment in terms of coming to Parliament, I think 6 monthly, to report to us on MAT standards. So just if you can address those points.
So the MAT standards, as you know, are important in terms of laying a foundation for change and the implementation and embedding of the new MAT standards is really important to make further progress building upon that, particularly around, you know, widening access to treatment, for example, and, you know, helping us integrate further addiction and mental health services and making all those links with primary care that we discussed earlier. So for the first time we've published the MAT standards, and there is a resource, a financial resource in terms of implementation. £4 million for this financial year was allocated to that, and crucially, and this is the, I suppose at the nub of Mr Kane's question, is that we have the MAT standard implementation support team. And what they're doing is they're looking at the reported progress from different areas, testing that progress and engaging with local areas about what support they need. Because I was very keen that we had missed, because the scale of the challenge to implement MAT is significant, because we're moving away from a 3-week waiting time target, that's what our system operates around, to turning a ship around that will provide, you know, for example, MAT Standard 1, which is about same day prescribing. So, you know, there's a lot of work to do. So progress is being made. It needs to be, it needs to be kind of whole area progress. And, you know, as with a range of other matters, we'll keep Parliament informed. But I think the other point to really recognise that absolutely we are serious about this target of April 2022, but the support doesn't just stop then. So that quality improvement and quality assurance and support role by the MIS team, which is part of a 3-year programme, continues. Because what we can't do is get it embedded, get it over the line, and then go, whew, job done. We're going to have to really keep on it. So the target, absolutely, April next year, but we will continue in that monitoring and supportive role. And we have some very clear asks from particular local authority areas that we are seeking to deliver on in terms of resource and help as quickly as possible.
Thank you. And linked to that, if I can, Minister, just on alcohol and drug partnerships, in terms of the role that they play, I think a very localised role in terms of the relationship they have to their IGB and in terms of the delivery that happens. In the context of the consultation on the National Care Service, there is obviously discussion around whether or not ADP should sit as part of a more national service delivery, or whether indeed they should remain more local. So I suppose keen to understand your view on that and where you think they can be most effective.
Yeah. So the National Care Service is the biggest reform in the NHS since 1948. You'll have heard Mr Stewart talk about this often. It is an immensely complex and challenging task to build a National Care Service and deliver it over the lifetime of this Parliament. But in my view, it is also a very significant and exciting proposition. It is about, at a very fundamental level, how we care for people and how we value those who care for people. And bearing in mind, people with drug-related difficulties are amongst the most marginalised and excluded and stigmatised within our communities, I think it's really important that we ask that question about what benefits are there for drug and alcohol services being part of, you know, the biggest change in our National Health Service in over 70 years. And, you know, some of the synergies in terms of what we're trying to do to improve services have a strong connection with work in a National Care Service about person-centred care, about informed choice, about not just caring and treating folk, but helping folk live their lives. So it's really important, and I felt very strongly about this, that that questions on drug and alcohol services should be part of that consultation. And, you know, that we needed, and what we need to test and explore as part of that consultation are the opportunities via the National Care Service to improve accountability, to improve governance. I think to improve the status of drug and alcohol work. I know that certainly some people involved in delivering and working in services don't just feel it's the people they serve that are stigmatised. I think they sometimes feel that, you know, they're a bit forgotten and that the service is somewhat stigmatised. And I do very much believe it about accountability at every level, and I have an interest and a focus on governance, I can assure you of that. The challenge in terms of alcohol and drug partnerships is that partnership needs to be at a local level, and sometimes at a very local level if we're going to reach into those communities that are most deprived and most disadvantaged. So that's kind of issues that we're testing now, and you know, the National Care Service is about a rights-based approach, and that fits with what we're trying to achieve in terms of improving drug and alcohol services. But we need to, there's much, it's in the consultation, and there are, you know, some quite deep and fundamental issues that we need to test out.
With your indulgence, Convener, you know, I think I would agree with much of what the Minister said, certainly in terms of that need for local connections and accountability, and improving, I think, the status of those services. I think it will be interesting to see the views, certainly, of people within the consultation. I wonder if I can ask, though, about alcohol and drug partnership reporting in the here and now. Government had previously committed to providing information from ADPs in terms of the spending by IJBs, both in 16-17 and 17-18. I think the last time we had figures on that, and that was going to be a kind of baseline, I think, for future reporting. There hasn't been any further information since that time, and I think as part of the intelligence for us to understand what is working on a local level and where spend is going, it would be helpful, I think, to have that further information. So I wonder if the Minister would say something about that, and I think what other intelligence can we garner from ADPs that will help us to map some of this and to meet those VAT standards?
So in terms of alcohol and drug partnerships, I think it's fair to say that we are making a bigger ask of them. It's part of the quid pro quo for the bigger investment in funding that's been made. They've had an uplift this year of £13.5 billion from the National Mission Funds. And we've been very specific about the proportions of that to be spent on family and child services, residential rehabilitation and aftercare, and other frontline services. And we've also agreed a framework in and around governance with COSLA. And maybe I'll speak with COSLA, see if that might be information that might be of interest to committee as well. And that's about, essentially about forward planning, you know, that this isn't just about, you know, writing an annual report on, you know, what has been done. It's about undertaking more work to assess local need, to evaluate what you're doing. There is some external validation built into that, and it's about forward planning. What are you going to be doing over the next year? And again, you know, we are supporting ADPs in and around how to do that. There's also some agreements that we came to COSLA about the role of chief finance officers and integrated joint boards and their role in all of this, and also the role of things like service level agreements between, you know, the alcohol and drug partnership and the people who they commission services with. But again, I'm cognizant of the role of alcohol and drug partnerships vis-a-vis integrated joint boards too. In terms of your fundamental question about understanding the total spend, so it's very clear for government to articulate, you know, in the drugs policy division, you know, how much we're spending and what on. There's obviously budget information in terms of what we're spending on drug and alcohol services, you know, overall and all our budget documentations. But then when you're looking at, you know, what then do local government put in from their funds and then what additional funds come from the IGB or NHS, I appreciate the picture becomes far more complex. And I understand committee's interest in this. And it would indeed be beneficial to know the size of the total investment. And it is, you know, a question I am interested in too. I hope that, you know, some of the work that we're undertaking in government might help with that. But I think it may be helpful, convener, when I next meet with Councillor Curry from COSLA, that I discuss it with him, because I know you've expressed an interest in this over a number of years, and I'll discuss with Councillor Curry from COSLA, the health and social care spokesperson, about, you know, looking ahead, building on the new governance arrangements that we've agreed for the here and now, how we might begin to shed light on that. The issue is this information should be available at a local level, but we'll try and unravel it. I don't think we'll necessarily unravel it quickly, convener, if I can just, you know, for the sake of my officials, add to that, because they are, you know, engaged in increasing capacity in residential rehab, implementing MAT standards and a whole host of other work. But I give you an undertaking to at least explore this with COSLA.
OK, thank you. Move on to questions from David Torrance. David.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. As far back as 2017, there was a public petition raised on the harms of prescription drugs, and the Short Working Life Group took this up and made its recommendations in March this year. Also in January, the First Minister announced a national mission to reverse the deaths from prescription drugs. Minister, what progress has been made on the dependency around prescription drugs?
So there's two really important strands to this. Committee will appreciate that the focus of my work in terms of reducing drug-related deaths is primarily, although not exclusively, focused on illicit drug use. And, you know, colleagues in public health will be more focused in doing more work in and around how we reduce dependency on prescribed drugs. But that is also, you know, of interest to me, because we do know, I'm not telling you something you don't know, that people, you know, can and do become addicted to prescribed drugs. And some of the work that was undertaken by the Short Life Working Group, there was a consultation on those recommendations. Health colleagues are implementing an action plan in and around that, and some of that's about prescribing guidance. It's around, you know, assessing, monitoring and recording. I know it's a slightly side issue. I know that when I met with the Royal Pharmaceutical Society, they are very interested in how we could how they could work with government to implement a tool that better records the amount of over-the-counter medications, you know, people are buying, because that's also for some people an issue as well. But the prescribing guidance around prescribed drugs is complementary to the prescribing guidance in and around illicit benzodiazepine use, because the issue here for the drugs policy division is to connect the work to reduce dependency and use of illegal illicit benzodiazepines that are in our community, that is, you know, not unconnected to the work around prescribed benzodiazepines, for example. So there's a range of work that we're doing to tackle the issue around street Valium as well. Some of it's devolved, some of it's reserved. But I'll stop there, convener. Somebody may want to pick up the benzodiazepine issue later.
No. Emma, you wanted to come in on this issue? Or
on tackling stigma?
Or? Yes, I'll bring you in now on that, yes.
Okay, no. Just a quick question. It's a very complex issue and there's lots of strands that are being worked upon. And one of the ones that I was interested in previous questions in Chamber was tackling stigma. And we know that the Scottish Drugs Task Force, in collaboration with other partners, have an actual strategy for addressing stigmatisation amongst people, communities, families. And for me, especially in a rural area, it's an issue as well. Are you able to tell us a little bit about how important it is to tackle stigma so that the media are using the correct images or the better images, and also, you know, areas where even healthcare professionals that are not working in direct services with alcohol and drugs users, that so people like myself, when I worked in recovery room, had a better understanding around the use of stigmatising language.
So we know stigma is a huge barrier to people accessing treatment, and it's an issue that has a huge impact on people's well-being as well, and impacts on how people are treated within services and within the community. And we, as parliamentarians, have a role to play in this, as well as the media and services and the wider public sector workforce. So some of that work around a trauma-informed workforce is really important as well in this regard. But Ms Harper raised the issue about the charter, the lived experience representatives and engagement with other lived experience groups have developed a stigma, an anti-stigma charter. And the purpose of that charter is that it can be used by different organisations, different services, but actually adapted as well. You know, so that I would describe the charter as quite core in terms of its purpose, but can be adapted to other services. The National Naloxone campaign, part of that is about stigma, that these are lives that we can and must save, and here's how we do it. And it's about engaging the wider population about what they can do to help save lives as part of the national mission. And also, later on in this year, we'll report back to Parliament about a national stigma campaign as well.
Good. Gillian Mackay.
Just a very quick question this time. People who use drugs may be subject to multiple stigmas, not just that related to their drug use, such as homelessness, that relating to the mental health, and for some HIV status. How will the government ensure that the multiple stigmas are tackled within systems that people who use drugs use, not just their drug use and the stigma surrounding that?
Yeah, no, I mean, you're quite correct to be making all those connections, and again, you know, it's important that strategies and approaches, you know, complement each other and connect with each other as well. And there's also a lot to learn from other campaigns and approaches as well. Absolutely.
I'm going to bring Annie Wells in. Annie, I believe you have some questions around residential rehab that you want to put to the minister.
Yes, I do. Thanks, convener. The Scottish Government's residential rehab mapping report stated that the government funded only 13% of residential rehab places in Scotland in 2019-2020. And promises have been put forward regarding funding and places. But can the minister tell me how many extra residential rehab beds will be available by the end of this year?
So what we know, Ms Wells, from that information, that 13% of beds that were accessed in that time frame came from alcohol and drug partnerships funding, that there was also publicly funded places from housing benefit and social security, and that there was, you know, people would be accessing private funding and charitable funding as well. In terms of the first calendar quarter of this year, you might recall that we
published information on how the emergency funding was used. So January to March, we quickly initiated £5 million out the door. £3 million of that went to ADPs. You know, some of that money was for a kind of separate improvement fund that people could apply for, there was also a grassroots fund. And in terms of how ADPs allocated that money, we published that, so that is available. We are currently gathering further information from ADPs, and again, we will make that available. What we know in terms of current capacity, again, earlier this year, we published that overall the 20 facilities in Scotland, that they were operating about two-thirds of capacity. So we know that there is a capacity there to be utilised, and I have given a commitment to return to Parliament with our milestones over the next 5 years. Again, that's about how to improve access, but also, as Ms Wells rightly points out, to what extent will we improve capacity over the next 5 years as well. So we will come to Parliament with much more of the detail on that.
Thank you.
Can I have one more question, Convener?
Yes.
Sorry, my dog's barking as well. Just one more question, Minister. I have repeatedly spoke about the Right to Recovery Bill, which will be getting laid before Parliament in the next couple of weeks. And we've worked with frontline organisations who say this bill is the right thing to do. Can I ask, would the Minister be willing to back the bill when it comes forward once you've seen the content?
So I'm really keen to look at the bill in detail. Obviously, it needs to be published before I can give it full consideration. If Ms Wells is pursuing a members' bill, there's a well-trodden path there about the requirements on the member to consult and engage and convince others of their proposition, and there's a well-trodden path in terms of what considerations governments give to members' bill. I think I've got a track record of always giving members a fair hearing. I will look at this on its merits. I have never ruled out the need for further legislation, but I will want to, I suppose, test whether the bill will do what it claims to do. I don't want to, you know, there's a process in and around legislation. I don't want that to hold us back from doing things now. I will want to see how any bill actually helps us with the integration of services. I've already, I suppose, outlined, you know, some of my rationale about why I wanted alcohol and drug services to be part of the National Care Service consultation, and obviously the government will bring forward a bill on establishing a National Care Service. The consultation development and responses will help inform if and how drug and alcohol services are or are not part of this. I do think there is just thinking about the National Care Service, I do think there's a strong argument for national commissioning of residential rehabilitation. I can say more about that if people wish. And we also have a commitment as a government, you know, further down the track in terms of human rights implementing international treaties. How do we make human rights real in people's lives and communities? And I think that's, you know, a very broad issue as well. So that will be, that will also inform my thinking about my response to any bill that's brought forward. And I think it's also important as well, and I do apologise for the time I'm taking, Convener, that we have made a commitment to a national collaborative. And a national collaborative is about how those with lived and living experience plug into the national mission. So a national collaborative isn't something that you do to people. It's about enabling the wider lived and lived experience community having their say and respond on a whole range of issues. But in short, we'll look at the detail of the bill when it comes.
Okay, I just want to check in with Marie McNair. Marie wanted to come in on a question around the inequalities aspect of things. So before we move on to our next theme around COVID-19, can I see if Marie still wants to ask that question? Marie?
Yeah, I wanted to take the Minister briefly back to the impact of the deprivation. You know, we've long been aware for a long time that, you know, the link between deprivation and drugs. And I worry really that whilst we study this fact, more avoidable deaths are occurring. How do we get the balance right between the risk of analysing this link and getting meaningful data that helps us respond to the main reasons of it?
So I won't repeat what I said to, I think, Mr O'Kane about the purpose of more data and what we're doing to acquire more meaningful information. But let me assure Ms McNair that, you know, the purpose of the work that I'm leading within government is to turn words into actions. And in terms of that link between deprivation and drug deaths, again, I refer back to some of my answers that I gave to Ms Mackay around, you know, the additional funding and action in things like, you know, the Child Poverty Action Plan, the Child Poverty Annual Report, tracking work, the Fair Work Agenda, the work that's been done in and around social security, the work we're doing in early years, you know, the massive expansion of early years for our youngest citizens, the work to reduce the attainment gap, all of that is absolutely connected, and at its core is about addressing the impacts of deprivation on every aspect of people's lives.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to talking about the impact of COVID-19 and questions from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. I wanted to ask you, you know, just thinking about COVID, clearly it hasn't hit everybody equally and people have struggled to access treatment and access support. What I'm really interested in is what kind of specific changes to approach and treatment during COVID has actually had a positive impact, and how do we maximise the benefits of that going forward to make sure that we're taking that learning forward with us and using it to support and help people?
Okay. So I think one example would be Buvidal, which was introduced into the prison estate during the pandemic. Buvidal is a long-acting buprenorphine which can be administered by a weekly or monthly injection, so it doesn't require, you know, a daily dosage. And there was very positive evaluation around the use of Buvidal in prisons, in that, I mean, it won't suit everybody. I think it's important to stress with any treatment, it won't meet the needs of everyone. But it had some benefits in terms of clarity of thought, not tying people to daily dispensing. And also, it is rarely, you know, associated with overdose, as it has a protective factor in and around how opioids attach to brain receptors. It's a bit like a blocker. If you take an opioid on top of your Buvidal, you don't get the effects of it or the high from it. So I was very keen that, having looked at the results of Buvidal within some of our prison estate, that actually how can we introduce that to the community? How can we widen access to treatment? And that's why there's a £4 million investment this financial year to widen choice to people, and that includes Buvidal. And that's obviously that widening choice of treatment is a change in practice that occurred in response to the pandemic, but it is one that we want to continue and implement further in the community. I've already spoken about our work in and around the naloxone as well, and how, you know, that distribution was widened over the pandemic, and we don't want to detract from that.
Can I bring in Marie McNair on this? particular theme on COVID-19. Marie?
Oh, I thought you were finished. No, Marie, I'll stop you there because I didn't realise that Stephanie was wanting to ask a supplementary. So, Stephanie, carry on.
Sorry, convener, my apologies. Again, just thinking about the impact of COVID, I think we've all realised, you know, the way that isolation and the connections to our families and how important they are for us to stay healthy mentally. But not everybody has that support. And I'm wondering as well, you know, you spoke about the promise earlier on, and that talks about how those relationships and that trust that you build with other people going forward, you know, not just with families, but actually with organisations that provide support, really helps you sustain progress. So my question is round about, you know, how are we looking at actually sustaining that progress? So as people are coming through addiction and starting to move on with their lives, we all hit struggles at some point in time. And how do we make sure that they're able to connect back in and get the support that they need just as they move forward?
So tackling social isolation is also a public health issue. Members may be aware that a few years back that the government introduced its tackling isolation and loneliness strategy as well, and there's a range of investments and funds around that. But I think in terms of tackling drug-related deaths aspect, I mean, I have to point to the lived experience and the recovery community, because much of what they do is based on their own real-life experience and the expertise that they bring to the community. And mobilising the lived experience community can help reach people that, you know, maybe services might struggle to reach. And that relationship aspect of support is crucially important. And things like the peer navigator system that Violence Against Medics Against Violence have been strong proponents of, you know, within our prison system and within our hospital system are really important as well. And a lot of these peer navigators from organisations such as Aid and Abet too, that's about, you know, making people with lived experience, making contact with people when they come into police custody. All of that is about making those connections and building a relationship with people and supporting them and helping them in their onward journey, as well as, you know, referring them to services potentially too.
Thank you. I'll bring in Millie now. Millie.
Thank you, convener. COVID-19 has had a negative impact on many in our society, and I'm very concerned about its impact on deprived communities and how this may be turbocharged when the UK government removes the £20 universal credit uplift later on this month. As COVID-19 made it more difficult for people in deprived communities to access drug services, and is there a concern that the welfare changes will make that challenge much more?
So there were, of course, great challenges people accessing services during lockdown. I do have to say that the work of the lived experience community was particularly helpful and particularly imaginative. The government worked with organisations such as the Scottish Recovery Consortium on guidance about how to, you know, continue to have meetings, whether that was, you know, online or, you know, in parks and open air settings or over the phone. And I know that, for example, the recovery community in Glasgow did amazing work throughout the pandemic. There are other you know, smaller organisations like Recovery Enterprises Scotland, which are based down in East Ayrshire, really, you know, were under quite an enormous strain during the pandemic as a smaller organisation, and that's why Some of the new funds that I introduced are particularly geared at smaller, more local grassroots organisations so that they can, you know, have a fund that they can access, funding that can help them with their work in their community, and we've worked hard to make that funding as easy as possible to access. There's no doubt about it that so-called welfare reforms has an impact on the lives of the poorest, and I suppose that the frustration for many of us around this table, while there's an increasing investment in the Scottish Child Payment, which will lift, you know, tens of thousands of children out of poverty, yet, you know, we're seeing, you know, a cut, the temporary increase in the universal credit, the £20, is going to be taken away from people when actually, you know, we're still not out of COVID, and we're a far way away from recovery, both socially and economically.
Thank you, Marie.
And are there any positive responses as a reaction to COVID that we would want to keep post-pandemic?
So, yes, and convener, I think I have outlined those discussions with previous members, and maybe Ms McNair's connection's not that good. So in terms of our work around Buvidal, our work around Naloxone, what I haven't mentioned, some of the work around prison to rehab, there was a £1.9 million investment in that, and I think the work and the contribution made by the lived experience and recovery community throughout the pandemic should remind us well about the value of engaging and meaningfully engaging with and not just paying lip service to the recovery community and those with lived and living experience. And that's why we want to take that work further forward with our work on a national collaborative.
Thank you. There's a couple of members wanting to ask questions around funding, and that will be the last theme that we touched on. I thank the Minister for the huge amount of information that she's given us already. Can I bring in Emma Harper?
Yep. Thank you, Convener. So all of this discussion that we've had this morning, Minister, obviously requires financial input, and I am aware that the Scottish Government have committed to increasing funding. There was 5 million at the remainder of the last financial year, and then there was an allocation of an additional £50 million funding each year, so that will be a total of £250 million over the next Parliament, which will support further investment in a range of community-based interventions, including primary prevention and expansion of residential rehabilitation, which you've covered a wee bit of already. So I'm interested, Minister, if are you able to kind of support a breakdown of how the funding's allocated, and for the alcohol and drug partnerships to be spending that money and then reporting back, and how that will be assessed and evaluated, for instance.
Okay, so in terms of the £5 million, which was an additional resource that was released at the last quarter of the last financial year, but the first calendar quarter of this year, £3 million of that went to alcohol and drug partnerships. And as I mentioned earlier, we published their returns on how that was invested. There was also £1 million put into a grassroots fund, and there was £1 million put into a service improvement fund. So at the turn of the year, at the turn of the financial year, after Easter, March the 18th, I announced four new funds, totalling £18 million. These are multi-year funds, I hasten to add. These four new funds opened in May. So there is a £5 million recovery fund. There is a £5 million service improvement fund. There is a £5 million local fund, again geared towards grassroots organisations, and there's a £3 million family and children's fund. And these are available via CORA for all non-profit making organisations to apply for, and we've worked really hard to make the application process accessible and quick. And to date, we have funded in excess of around 50 projects through that. And I think when you add in other funds in terms of, you know, the work that, for example, the task force has done, I think we've funded over 80 specific projects. In terms of what we'll invest this year in residential rehab, that will be around £13.5 million, and that will come from ADPs, but also the Recovery Fund and other sources of funding within government. And when I come back to Parliament, I will outline in more detail the profile of that funding, because we've got a commitment of £100 million in residential rehab and aftercare over five years. But in terms of the £50 million for this year, there is also a £13.5 million uplift, specific uplift to ADPs that I've mentioned. And then there is around £14 million that is going on things like £3 million for outreach, £3 million for non-fatal overdose, £4 million on widening the distribution of Buvidal, and £4 million to implement the MAT standards. So hopefully that gives you an overview. And there's a little bit of resource going on research, but there's also resource set aside for the national stigma campaigns as well, and our lived and living experience strategy work in terms of establishing the national collaborative too.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for breaking all the finances down. I know a lot has been made of residential rehab and the costing of that. Just scanning BBC articles, Castle Craig is mentioned, and it's £2,500 a week for one person. But then there's obviously a variety of residential approaches, and I know the number of residential beds has increased in Scotland. We're now at 418 when it was 365 previously, so that's a bit of good news. And I'm looking at some I guess the whole broadness of the residential rehabilitation and the variety of costings of that, and looking at the work that the Scottish Government is doing to look at the best tailored person-centred approach for each person. And you've talked about families and Phoenix Futures as well. So I guess my question is about the assessing all of these pathways for funding will be something that you'll be able to come back and report to us either in Chamber or at committee in the future about how all of that is working.
So in terms of residential rehab, the average cost, and it's just an average cost per placement, is around £17,000. In some areas it is greater. There is also a variation in terms of the length of placement, and you know, this is something that the residential development working group, you know, has looked at in detail. I don't necessarily want to be prescriptive about the length of stay in residential care. You know, care needs to be, you know, person centred, and there needs to be a flexibility in services. And you know, we need to recognise that residential rehab, as well as the link with aftercare that Ms Mackay spoke of, that there's also a link with detoxification services as well. And some residential rehabilitations unit have kind of in-house detox, you know, some don't. So it is important that we are always thinking about the journey that people will take, and the services and opportunities and the care that they need on that journey.
Just post-residential recovery is all, and part of that is what needs to be continued after somebody does a stay in a residential place. So that's part of the funding as well. And assertive outreach is another thing that's active as well. So again, it's about lots of strands to try and support people through through this whole process. And third sector and charities are really important as part of any funding model that we consider as well.
So in short, convener, we need to stick with people. There is an important role for us to reform and change how our statutory or our NHS or local government services work in terms of how they meet the needs of people and their families that are struggling with issues in and around drugs. But there is a valuable role for the third sector. So we have taken that belt and braces approach. So as well as increasing investment to ADPs, many of whom will enter into agreements with the third sector, there are four funds that I've outlined earlier within that £18 million pot, multi-year funds that is available for third sector organisations to access. So the role of the third sector, along with our public services, along with the lived and living experience community, is all vitally important. And that these are the three strands of partnership, you know, the lived and living experience community, the third sector, and statutory services.
Thank you. And final questions from Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Minister. I have a number of questions. And just to correct what you said initially, I'm a practicing GP at the moment, so I'm still working. I have a question about the standards of the medication-assisted treatment. So number seven, all people have the option of mat shared with primary care. Could I ask you to define primary care?
So primary care is multidisciplinary. That is often led by general practitioners, but primary care is located within our communities. It is often the first port of call. It is supported with nursing staff as well. And there are efforts to connect GP practices, such as the work in and around deep end practices, with the voluntary sector and, you know, welfare advice as well. I'm sure perhaps my health colleagues and colleagues in public health may well have a more technical definition or description, but that would be how I see general practices.
Okay, and so with number seven in particular, have the option to have mat shared with primary care. Could you just explain that in a little bit more detail? So would that mean that the patient would be with an organisation and that would count as primary care? Or would it be that it would have to be with the GP that they have the option for?
So I suppose a lot would depend what the nature of the care they are receiving. So if we are talking specifically about medication-assisted treatment, that needs to be delivered by someone who is, you know, qualified to prescribe. But the important thing about the medication-assisted treatment standards is that it also makes connections with other aspects of treatment in terms of what is collectively known as psychosocial treatment and work to help people address past trauma. So a lot would depend on the type of care that we're talking about and the type of care available within a local practice.
Okay, so certainly, again, staying on number seven, a person qualified to prescribe the medication, certainly at the moment, all GPs don't do that. And most probably don't, actually. So is this something that you would like to see happen more?
So practice varies. So in the Lothians, for example, my understanding from NHS Lothian is that the majority of GPs, you know, are involved or could be involved in prescribing medication-assisted treatment to their patients. In other parts of the country, the practice has been that people have been referred to more specialist, more centralised addiction services, and an example of that would be in Tayside. So as well as supporting GP practices and the resources and the range of services and support they need to serve our communities, we also have to recognise that for that there are vital connections for patients here with who are receiving medication-assisted treatment and their primary care needs. And I know from my engagement with GPs that laying aside the issue of who prescribes a medication-assisted treatment, I think every GP that I've encountered with also say that they could do more at a community level with the, for example, the physical needs and physical care that people who live with drug use experience. They will often have, you will know this better than me, they will often have other health issues and that can be addressed by accessing primary care.
Absolutely, and GPs certainly would, I certainly would look after my patients' needs, but it was sort of more specifically about who does the prescriptions of the medication. And would there be increased funding given to general practice?
So the funding arrangements for general practice sit with the Cabinet Secretary for Health, and I can assure you that he engages very well and very often with the GP community and the whole host of issues that flow from the GP contract. I do have, you know, opportunities with the additional resource that we have to reduce drug-related deaths. You know, that actually isn't prescriptive about, you know, I haven't for a minute said, well, all of that money goes to ADPs or all of that money goes to the third sector. It is about investing in services and approaches where the evidence shows that lives can be saved.
Okay. And I was very heartened to hear that you said you've got a focus on governance. So with that in mind, how will you be assessing these standards, the 10 standards that you've got out?
So, yes, I do have a focus on governance and implementation. And I think I answered that question when Mr. O'Kane asked me the very same question, or paraphrased the very same question, that as well as providing practical support through the medication, the medication-assisted treatment implementation support team, known as MIST, to get these 10 standards embedded by next April, that their work also covered at least a three-year period that is about quality improvement and quality assurance. Because I think I said to Mr. O'Kane, the last thing we wanted to do was put all this additional investment in time, resource and support to get these standards embedded, and then to sit back and relax, because we can't sit back and relax. We need to keep on this.
Absolutely, and I did listen to the answer that you gave to Mr. O'Kane, but I suppose more specifically is how, what measures are going to be in place for this?
So in terms of the quality assurance and the quality improvement that will underpin the ongoing work of the MIST team, when I introduce a target for treatment, which will be at the turn of the year, there will be indicators underlying that treatment target that relate to more qualitative information that will be informed by our experience of implementing MAT standards.
Okay, just lastly... Absolutely.
Because we're running out of time.
The last question. When you introduce this target, what happens if you don't achieve it?
Oh, well, that will be for others to decide. Let me just say to Mr. Gullihan that my focus isn't on my own future. I've been around Parliament and I've been around government before. I had a life before I was a parliamentarian, and my focus is on just getting the work done.
Right. So I want to thank the Minister for the time that she spent with us this morning, and in particular for the update, but also for the offers of specific information on services around the country. I think that would be really helpful for us, because obviously we're looking at our work programme for the next year, so that kind of information would be really helpful. So thank you to the Minister and to her officials for joining us this morning. At its next meeting on the 21st of September, the committee will host two roundtable discussions with key stakeholders to explore Session 6 priorities in relation to public health and NHS policy, respectively. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you, everyone.